Can you hear me well?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Okay, so first of all, thank you for the invitation. I am Josu Hernández, and today I want to talk about the Sterile researches in a small experiment, DUNE, and IceCube. So I will present the results of these two papers. Here, the first one was made in collaboration with Matías Pleno, La Colomba, Josu Hernández, and Jacobo López Pavón. And the second one, which was the analysis of IceCube, which was made in collaboration with Matías Pleno, Josu Hernández, Josu Hernández, and Josu Hernández. So this result, Julia has already introduced the source of analysis in the DSD forum. So if you want to know details, follow my talk, and then you can make more questions during the discussion or even during the quarter session of tomorrow. So we have a theory that we call standard model. We know that it is successful because it predicts a lot of phenomena that have been tested in a huge variety of experiments with incredible accuracy. However, as Belén told us this morning, there are some open problems in the standard model. Among all of the open problems, I consider that the neutrino masses are one of the best open windows to look for these new physics, and this is why we have focused our two analyses on the phenomenological implications when we enlarge the standard model to account for the neutrino masses. So let's consider that the neutrinos are massive, and therefore, like the Carlos in the quark sector, the equilibrium is aligning with the mass and the flavor basis. This rotation is given by the PMNS matrix. And as a consequence, when we produce a neutrino of a flavor alpha via charge-carrying interactions, it will be a combination of the massive neutrinos. And when they propagate at distant air in vacuum, they are quite different phases that come from the different masses that they have. So as a consequence, I can detect via charge-carrying interactions again the neutrino as a neutrino with a different flavor theta because of the interference of these phases. So this gives us the neutrino oscillation probability that I think you are familiar with, but I wanted to start with this just to make sure that you are following all the steps. So the probability depends on the elements of the PMNS matrix and on the Hamiltonian that the vacuum is just the mass splitting of the neutrinos. This Hamiltonian is slightly modified in presence of matter because neutrinos can travel through matter and getting coherent scattering in the layers of the media. And therefore, we can have this charge-carrying potential that depends on the electron density of the media and neutral carrying interactions with the neutrons of the atoms. So this is the second part of the neutral carrying interaction with the neutrons. For approximately constant matter density, this is when we are not crossing all the layers of the air, the Hamiltonian can be generalized in the flavor basis, and as a result, we have this, the probability in matter. That again implies that neutrino oscillations are only possible if the neutrinos are massive and they are not degenerate. However, in the standard model, the neutrinos are explicitly massless, and this implies that the standard model has to be extended to account for this neutrino oscillation that we have measured. One possibility is the type 1 CISO, when we enlarge the standard model particle content with an arbitrary number of right-handed neutrinos. So this is our new Lagrangian that contains the derivable interactions of the neutrinos, so now we have Dirac masses for the neutrinos, like we have in all the fermions in the standard model. But we have a completely new term, which is the lambda Majorana master for the right-handed neutrinos, and it has a characteristic mass scale, this MN, where the electron number is broken. And this new scale will not be related with the hierarchy protocol, with the electrolytic breaking, sorry. So it doesn't have to be on the order of the electroweak scale. And in this one, we don't have a clue of where we have to set this mass. And this is why we need experimental verification. Indeed, we can have very different phenomenology depending on where we set this scale. In the very low energy regime, the neutrinos are kinematically accessible in the experiment, and we call them sterile neutrinos. And on the contrary, when we are in the large regime for large masses, we call them non-unitarity because they are decoupled from the theory, but they induce non-unitarity in the mixing matrix. Indeed, the bounds that we can have for this kind of neutrinos are mainly different. For instance, in the high energy, in the high mass regime, we can get the bounds from the present precision data that we have in the experiments and the demonstrable observables. For instance, we did this global fit and we said that the missing has the order 10 to the minus 2. When we load down this, the mass scale, we recover the unitarity, but we enter in the regime that they are kinematically accessible in the experiment, so we can look for beta decay spectra or the meson decays in order to loop the deviations and to set constraints. For instance, they are even stronger constraints, 10 to the minus 4. Finally, the low energy mass, they participate in the deviation, so we can take the information of the final deviation experiment and to look for deviation compared to the standard model. And set the missions that are of the order of 10 to the minus 1. So at some point, they both different regimes that one has. This is when they are really, really heavy, that we call non-unitarity neutrinos, and when they are really, really light, and then we call light sterile neutrinos. These two limits will, in principle, impact the neutrino selection surface. So we wonder if it is possible to measure the both regimes and disentangle them in the neutrino selection experiments that we have. So let's move to the analysis in DUNE. But first we have to discuss the parameterization because we have enlarged the neutrino mass matrix. So this is going to be diagonalized by the full finitized matrix, the U, that can be described with, by different subplots, depending on the mixing of the particles. The first subplot contains information on the mixing of the light states and the active spectrum, and the theta subplot contains information of the heavy mixings. The other part is not present in the experiment, so we'll have to focus on this part. So this matrix used to be the GMNS matrix, but now it's not unitarity anymore, and the deviation of the unitarity comes from this theta matrix. This is called the ETA parameterization, ETA or parameterization, and it contains the information of the deviation of the unitarity. So it is a relation between the first and the second subplot, because we see that the N matrix is the product, the square of the heavy mixing. So the new physics is parameterized by these nine elements. All the new physics is involved in the nine parameters that we have in this matrix. However, there are other possible parameterization that we call alpha parameterization, and it is really useful when we compute neutrino oscillation probabilities because it has a lot of zeros in the matrix. So here now the division of the unitarity is given by the alpha, which is a lower triangular matrix, and it is a connection between the both parameterization, so we derive this scenario, so we can still use the bounds that apply for the eta parameterization to the alpha. So I'm going to use the alpha parameterization in the rest of the code. And now we can compute the probability that is dominating the both scenarios. In the first one, we are in the non-unitarity, very high masses, which means above the electroweak scale. So the neutrinos experiments are not produced in the experiment, so we have to sum here over the light state. So we have just the contribution of the N matrix. On the stereo neutrino case, when they are really light, we have to sum over all the states, so we have the same contribution plus the contribution of the heavy states plus the interference. What happens is that in the average sum regime, where when the mass splittings are larger than one, this term drops because the oscillation is too fast to be resolved. And then, since this is quadratic in theta and this is quadratic in theta, at leading order we recover that both probabilities of the two separate scenarios share the same phenomenology. So in principle, the non-unitarity and the average out stereo neutrinos are given by the same expression as leading order. However, the bounds that apply to the alpha element that appears here in the matrix are completely different. The ones that come from the non-unitarity are of the order of 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the minus 4. In the other scenario, in the average of the stereo neutrinos, we have to go to the experiments and to look for the present constraint bounds. For instance, this one that comes from NOMAD and that sets a constraint in the eta tau element, and we see that the bounds in this scenario are of the order of 10 to the minus 2, 10 to the minus 1. So there are two orders of magnitude. In principle, this is too small to be tested in the present and near future experiments, in the experiment, so we can forget about the measuring non-linearity in the neutrino-oscillation experiment, and we can focus on the average out scenario. And for that, we are going to use the DUNE experiment, which is going to be built in Fermilab. They use the protons of the main injector, synchronized with the fixed target, and they produce measures that they get into neutrinos. These neutrinos travel through the air, they reach first the near detector, and the second in the far detector, which is 1,300 meters away. And therefore, in this kind of experiment, what we are really measuring is the probability of the far detector or the one at the near detector. And this is why, because they are normalizing the flux and the cross sections information at the far detector compared to the one at the near detector. So now we can say another question, which is if the stellar neutrino oscillation are averaged out in the near detector too or not. Because if they are averaged out in the near detector, this means that they are averaged out in the full experiment, and then the probability is given by the ratio. So this is the case in which the non-unitarity of the stellars, they have the same phenomenology. On the contrary, when they have developed the oscillation in the near detector, the denominator is 1, so this is the probability in the undeveloped case. What happens is that for the DUNE setup, the non-unitarity is happening for masses squared over the 100 electron volts, while this other scenario is happening just in this region, between 0.1 and 1 electron volts squared. So now we produce the simulations of DUNE, and as a result, we have these contours. The red one is 1 sigma, black is 90%, and blue at 2 sigma. The solid lines correspond to the DUNE sensitivity, to the new physics parameters, while the dashed lines correspond to the DUNE sensitivity when we combine the information of the present state. So using as a prior information the present state. And what we see is that for the average scenario, since the probability is given by the ratio, we are losing the sensitivity to the new physics parameters. The sensitivity is quite far away from the present bounds of the present experiments. And only on the undeveloped case that is happening for a very small window of parameters, we will improve the sensitivity to the new physics in DUNE. Another effect is that the DUNE will be able to disentangle the field legacy. However, in presence of new physics, like with the NSI, we will see that DUNE will not be able to resolve the generacy of the 2003 angle if unless they use the as information again the other experiments. So now I will move to the stereo neutrino searches in IceCube. So we have done for first time the analysis of the 1 year public data of IceCube at high energies. This means that the mass of the neutrinos, the stereo neutrinos, are above the 10 electron volts. So IceCube is the neutrino oscillation experiment in the South Pole. And we have what happens is that when a cosmic ray comes into the atmosphere, it produces particles that decay into muons. These muons are going to travel through the air. While they travel, they oscillate during the propagation, and eventually they can reach IceCube, which is here, and it can be detected. So IceCube is going to detect this survival probability of the new muon with a strong matter effect because they travel through the air. So before analyzing the data, we wanted to get an analytic expression in order to see what kind of behavior we expected in IceCube. And for that, we compute the new survival probability at the for average out continuous at IceCube. And this means that this average out scenario happens for mass splittings of the order of 100 electron volts squared. So we have computed the probability for the small mixing angles and neglecting the electron neutrino oscillations. And what we have is this probability that it looks like a subfamily approximation with some corrections from the new physics. However, since we are analyzing atmospheric neutrino data that has a lot of systematic errors, we are not going to be sensitive to these normalization factors, so we can neglect it and allow free normalization of the events in the analysis. the same happens with the leaking term. This term does not depend on the energy of the baseline, so we don't have sensitivity to this term. So this is the probability that it is dominating the regime of IceCube at higher energies. When we computed a leaking order in alpha and included atmospheric oscillation, we have this simple effect. So we see that the probability, the effect is coming from the matter effect. And when we go to the particular case of just one stellar neutrino in order to get the bounce, we have this final probability. So what we expect to have during the analysis is an hyperbolic state in the theta, in the missing with the tau versus the missing of the mu. So now we're going to analyze the 1 year public data. It contains information of the experiment during the 1 year, same years and a half ago. So the state was with 86 strings of detectors. They only include the upcoming track events. This is because IceCube is in the South Pole, so they just look for the neutrinos that are coming through the air in order to seal the bubble from cosmic neutrinos that come from the city. So the distance that are traveled during the propagation are of the order of 10 to the 4 kilometers. And the selected events that we have in the delta have represented energies between 400 GeV and 20 GeV, which is high energy neutrinos at IceCube, and retrograded semitangles between minus 1 and 0.0. So the semitangle is defined like this, this is IceCube, and this is the North Pole. So this means that they are considering neutrinos that come from the North Pole and close to the horizon. This range. So now for the analysis, we start computing the atmospheric neutrino class that we have, and for that we are going to use the Ontag-Geiser model plus the atomic model, this atomic model. This is what we have used for our analysis. However, we have done the analysis for different atmospheric models in order to see the impact of considering one model or the other. Then, when we compute the class of the neutrinos, we have to propagate them to the air, and for that we have used the new software, and then when we propagate the neutrinos for all the stereotypical parameters, we can get the number of events that we expected to have in the detector for every link of reconstructed semitangle. So, we have done for the semitangles, because since the observable is not energy independent at given order, we have used just one energy beam for all the data, while 40 beams for reconstructed semitangle. So now we can compute the neutralityhood, and we have the expected number of events versus the number of events of the data, and we minimize this likelihood for a set of nuisance parameters in order to include the systematic errors. And these are the pion to pion ratio of the atmospheric class, the efficiency of the detectors that are called the domes, you have seen some matches, and the overall class normalization that I drop in the probability. And finally, we have fixed the best fit value of the standard oscillation parameters to the best fit value of new fit. Then, as a result, we have this press constraints of the 1 year data that are in pink. This is for the 90% confidence level, this is for the 99%. This other region, this is already screwed by the combination of super K and deep core. So we see that with the 1 year public data at 99%, we are improving, IceCube is improving the bounce on the mixing. So what we test is a micro-tenance, as Peter explained, a micro-tenance for non-zero mixing, which has a significance of 2.3 sigmas. So we have seen that in our analysis, this preference of non-zero mixing is always present. However, the significance can range in between 1.6 and 3 sigma, depending on the plugs that we have adopted. So we change the model of the atmospheric neutrinos, the sensitivity, change a bit. Now, if we consider that nature is realizing this value, the one of the star, of the mixing parameters, so this star is the first fit of the 1 year data, we can perform a forecast of the AGR data that IceCube should already have right now. So this means this blue banana state is the preferred region that IceCube will have right now if nature is realizing this value of the mixing, of the Sterile mixing. So this means that if IceCube release the paper of the full analysis with the AGR data, they could either confirm or rule out the preferred region. On the other hand, there are other experiments, such as NOMAD, that they look for a different channel, they measure the medium in the car with the medium of an effect, because it's a zero distance effect, and this probability, or since they don't have the best, they can set a strong bound on the same plane. This bound comes here, it's not really seen because of the beamer, but well, the bound comes here and here. So NOMAD is already excluding all the preferred region of IceCube. However, in presence, because they are different channels, IceCube is measuring in mu mu with material text, while NOMAD is measuring in mu mu tau at zero distance, in presence of matter and MSI, both results could be reconciled. Finally, instead of realizing the mixing system at zero, so if we assume as a true value the zero mixing, we can get the present, by present I mean in 8 years, bound that IceCube could have in blue and in purple the constraint that they could have in 12 years more of data taking. And then just to summarize, we have seen that the non-linearity regime and the Sterile Neutrino that are the child, they serve the same terminology at leading order. However, the bounds that apply in the both limits are completely different, and that means that the non-linearity is not going to be observed in the present and near future experiments, also using experiments, while the light Sterile Neutrinos could be in principle confirmed or could be measured in neutrinos using experiments, and for that it is really important to consider the role of the near detector. In the IceCube analysis, we have performed the first analysis of the 1 year data, and we have as a result a non-zero mixing with a reference that ranges 0.75 up to 3 sigma, depending on the beam and on the flux that we adopt. At 99%, the constraints that we get are already improving over super KRD core bounds. However, the preferred region is excluded but not much, unless we are in presence of different pieces that are affecting in a different way in both experiments. And finally, the AGR of IceCube data that this will already have right now will be sufficient to either confirm or rule out this experience. So let's wait for the official analysis they are doing and they are about to publish in some weeks or months. Thank you.
Questions for Josu?
There was a paper trying to explain ANITA events. I was wondering whether the preferred region by IceCube on your data coincides with the parameter space that can explain ANITA results.
Yeah, this is true. Our preferred region that we get, this preferred region, it is in the region of that could explain the state and the sour of ANITA. So in principle, this is compatible with ANITA result.
Thank you. Questions anymore? I had a question. So when you were looking for this Sterile Neutrino bounds at DUNE, you had two cases, one in which it was not averaged out at the near detector oscillations. When you say it's not averaged out in the near detector itself can actually measure these oscillations and constrain the parameters. So has that been already taken into account automatically when you did that? So then, if the oscillations are not averaged out in the near detector will actually see a dip coming from the oscillations driven by the delta m squared.
I mean, this
if the oscillations are not averaged out, yes. The oscillations will be seen. I mean, you will
but this is the case when they have the bed of the oscillation, yeah. It's only all the bed.
Okay.
Yes.
So you know what's so the intermediate regime where the oscillations are fully developed and not averaged?
No, no, that is the intermediate regime that we have considered. When they are oscillating in the near detector and they are
in the in which case, of course, the near detector itself can actually constrain the oscillation to a very, very high precision.
True.
Especially at TV. So, if any more questions? If not, then let's thank Josu again. The next.